I'm going to drop a rubber ball and some putty. Will they behave the same way? Both will deform upon impact. The rubber ball exhibits elastic behavior. It will return to its original state and jump back up. The putty will react in an inelastic or plastic manner. The deformation will persist, and it will remain on the ground. Rocks and the Earth possess both characteristics. How seismic waves propagate is dependent on them. Hello and welcome. Seismic waves deform the rock they travel through. Only slightly, but they do. When this happens, the Earth behaves like the elastic rubber ball and the plastic putty at the same time. I will now explain to you how the elastic properties of the Earth make seismic waves possible and determine the velocity of the waves. On their path through the Earth, the amplitude of the waves decreases. The reason for this is plastic deformation. Let me show you why. Elastic properties describe deformation processes in all types of materials, including the Earth. In all cases, they describe how a material reacts on an external force. Here, the force F acts perpendicular to the area A. This is the normal stress sigma n. It results in a change of length, which is expressed as the strain epsilon. Under this stress, a body is stretched. How? This can be investigated for any medium in a mechanical press. But rocks in the Earth are also subjected to stress and strain, such as after an earthquake. The strain results from stresses in three dimensions. The state equations describe this via six elastic moduli. I will now introduce them to you. First, there's Young's modulus. In an experiment, a block of material is exposed to a normal stress and the block expands. Young's modulus is the proportionality constant between the normal stress sigma n and the resulting strain epsilon in the same direction. It is represented by E and is always positive. This means that a tension brings about an expansion of length. The rubber ball, for example, has a very low Young's modulus. Secondly, the longitudinal modulus M or Xi. Like Young's modulus, it indicates the ratio between normal stress and strain in the same direction. However, it does not permit lateral extensions. We can imagine this as a rigidly coated sample. The longitudinal modulus is always positive. It is generally larger than Young's modulus. Thirdly, the bulk modulus. In the experiment, the environmental pressure on a body changes by delta P. Subsequently, its volume V changes. This change in volume delta V as compared to the original volume V is then proportional to minus delta P. The bulk modulus K is therefore a measurement of incompressibility. The bigger K is, the smaller the resulting change in volume. Gases, therefore, have a large bulk modulus and can be compressed much more than solid media. Fourthly, the shear modulus or modulus of rigidity. This involves tangential forces. They act parallel to a surface and are called shear stresses sigma s. The shear modulus is represented by a small mu or a big g. Mu equals a ratio between shear stress and shear strain. The shear modulus is always positive. This means that the shearing always takes place in the direction of the stress applied. If mu equals zero, no deformation takes place at all. This indicates that the material is a liquid or a gas. Neither of them can be sheared. Fifth, Poisson's ratio. It is represented by nu and describes how elastic a body is. It is defined via the behavior during longitudinal compression. Here, the length L decreases by delta L, and the diameter d simultaneously increases by delta d. Maximum values are achieved for gases and liquids. They do not change their volume during compression. Here, nu has a value of 1/2. For ideally elastic bodies, it is 1/4. This applies as a first approximation for the Earth's crust and mantle, and, of course, for the rubber ball. We call these media Poisson bodies. Cork, on the other hand, has a value of around zero. That is why it is easy to push a cork into a bottle. Its diameter barely changes when this is done. Sixth, the Lamé parameter lambda. It is the most difficult to illustrate. The best description is probably a hypothetical experiment in a press. One has to imagine that pressure is built up on a test body in one direction. However, at the same time, no change in the expansion of the body is permitted in this direction. The expansion can only take place in the other two spatial directions. Lambda is then equal to the ratio of the normal stress in direction without deformation to the surface-wise expansion perpendicular to it. Lambda equals sigma 1 divided by epsilon 2 plus epsilon 3. Of these six moduli, only two are independent of each other in homogeneous isotropic media. One can always be described by two others. For the propagation velocity of the seismic body wave types P and S, the longitudinal modulus m and the shear modulus mu are crucial. The p-wave velocity vp equals the root of m divided by the density rho, or the root of lambda plus 2 mu divided by rho. The s-wave velocity vs is equal to the root of mu divided by rho. Hence, in addition to an elastic modulus, both also depend on the density of the propagation medium. With these velocities, the seismic P and S waves travel across the Earth. On their way, their amplitude, that is the extent of deformation, decreases. In part, this is because the energy is distributed over an increasingly large area as it propagates away from the source of the quake. This is a purely geometric but elastic effect. Also elastic are the refraction, reflection, and scattering of waves. However, this does not apply to the conversion of oscillation energy into heat. This is an inelastic or plastic effect. It is also called intrinsic attenuation. Let me explain it to you using this oscillating spring. Once stimulated, it oscillates with a constant frequency and comes to a stop after a while. The oscillation energy is converted into heat during the deformation. This is also the case in the Earth. Without inelasticity, earthquake waves would travel forever around the Earth. We can also describe this effect using the quality factor Q. It indicates the energy loss delta E per oscillation cycle. 1 divided by Q equals minus delta E divided by E over 2 pi. Hence, a small Q value indicates strong attenuation. We can use this to show that the amplitude of a seismic wave decreases with e to the power of 1 divided by q. Amplitude a equals the original value a0 times the exponential function of minus pr divided by q lambda with path r and the wavelength lambda. Let's assume a q value of 100 and a wavelength of 1 kilometer. For a seismic signal, this means the following attenuation. After 100 kilometers, the signal is only at 4% of the original value, through inelastic attenuation alone. Q is not constant, but instead dependent on multiple factors. For one, on the oscillation frequency. Waves from 0.1 to 1 Hz are generally attenuated more strongly than low-frequency waves. Hence, seismic signals close to an earthquake source have sharp displacements. Those that are far away lose the higher frequency through attenuation, resulting in longer periods. Secondly, Qs also depend on the wave type. The attenuation of S waves is generally greater than that of P waves, because shear deformations are attenuated much more than contractions. And thirdly, various rocks also have different Q values. For example, the Earth's crust attenuates waves less than the mantle. I have introduced to you the elastic and inelastic or plastic properties of the Earth. You have learned about the definitions of the elastic modules and how they determine the propagation velocity of body waves in seismology. The amplitude of the seismic waves decreases along their travel path. This is called attenuation. You've learned that inelastic attenuation is described via the quality factor Q. Hence, we see that the properties of a rubber ball and putty describe the propagation of seismic waves in the Earth. Thus, it is important to know these underground properties in as much detail as possible.
Thank you.